Hi, this is Professor Kleitz. In section 15-9, I'm going to talk about successive approximation analog to digital conversion. So other methods of A to D conversion employ up-down counters, integrating slope converters to track the analog input, but the method used in most modern ICs is called successive approximation. This converter circuit is similar to the counter ramp ADC, except the method of narrowing in on the unknown analog input voltage is much improved. Instead of counting up all the way from zero all the way up to the max like the successive approximation register is used in place of the counter. So let's take a look at the circuit for that. So this looks similar to the counter ramp. It's got the output register D flip-flop. It's got a D to A that's going to output a voltage that's going into the analog comparator. So again, you're going to have an analog voltage here, and you're going to step this voltage up on the minus terminal higher, higher, higher until it just barely exceeds the plus, and that's going to tell the SAR to stop. So when you first press the start convert, so that's going to be a high to low edge, as soon as that happens, the SAR tries the MS bit. Now the MS bit going into the DAC is going to output half of the maximum value, which will be 5 volts. So it tries 5 volts on this terminal. Now let's say the analog input is 6.8 volts. I'll just make that up, 6.8 volts. So when this outputs half of the value, it says, oh, well, 6.8 on this terminal, this is going to have 5 on it now. This is going to come out with a positive value, and the SAR says, okay, we're not there yet. Let's try the D6 bit. Now the D6 is going to be 1/4 of the maximum, so that's going to be 2.5 volts. So now it's outputting the 5 on this leg and the 2.5, that's a total of 7.5 on VL. Now it's above the value that we wanted, so it outputs a 0. The SAR says, oops, we outputted too much. Let's get rid of the D6. Instead, let's try the D5 along with the D7. Now D5 is going to be 1.25. So at 1.25, you add that along with the 5, that gives you a value of 6.25. That's still not quite enough if our input was, in the example in the book, I'm using 6.84 volts. So in other words, it keeps trying each one of these bits, and it either keeps it or throws it away. By the time it's tried 8 possible choices, it's narrowed in on the closest value it can get to the actual V out that you need to compare to the input over here. As soon as that happens, the SAR says, okay, I'm done, I've tried all 8 bits, and it issues a high to low pulse on the DR data ready line, and that pulse goes into the output register as a clock, and it triggers these D's to go out to the Q's. The process is over. So let's look at the waveforms that get created with an SAR. So to look at the waveforms, let's look at example 15.4. We're going to try for the value 6.84. So I made a chart to help you see what each voltage level contribution will be for each successive bit. So the D7, like I said, is half of the max. That would be 5. This is 1/4 of the max, 2.5, and so on, all the way down to, this is about 39 millivolts for the D0 bit. And so here's the waveforms. We got a 100 kHz clock buzzing along. Somebody issues a start convert line. As soon as that goes low, the data ready goes inactive. It says, I'm not ready, and it's not going to be ready again until the end of the 8th pulse. So like I said, it tries the D7 bit. It makes it high, and it goes down and tries to see what the voltage would be on the output of the DAC. Well, that's going to output a 5. It's looking for 6.84, so it says, oh, okay, I'll keep that. So it keeps the D7 bit, and then it tries the D6 bit, and it says, oops, that pushed me over the limit. It put me up at 7.5. It gets rid of it and makes that line, returns it to a low. The D7 stays high. Let's try the D5 in conjunction. The D5 puts it up to that's that extra 1.25, that puts it up to 6.25. It says, oh, I'm okay with that. So it keeps that. Then it tries the D4 bit. The D4 bit pushes it over the limit, so it takes that back out again. And then it tries the D3 bit, and it keeps it. Tries the D2 bit, keeps it. D1 bit keeps it, D0 bit keeps it, and it keeps narrowing in closer and closer and closer to the final answer, which is 6.835. And remember, we were looking for 6.84, so obviously we're pretty darn close. And the cool thing about this is it only took 80 microseconds, and the final digital output is, here's the MS bit up here, so it'll be 10101111. It takes that value, pushes it into the D8-bit flip-flop register, and the outputs appear for the conversion. So the Q0 through Q7 lines that came out have the answer, and that corresponds to this voltage 6.8359375, which has an error of only 0.0594%. And I found the percent error by taking the actual voltage minus the final DAC output and divided by the actual voltage and multiplied by 100%, and that's the percentage. That's pretty darn close. Okay, so now it's time to look at some actual ADCs. The NE5034 and the ADC0804 are pretty inexpensive. I use these in lab all the time. They're $2 or $3. It's not as cheap as a logic gate, but still it's not too expensive, because ADCs can get up into the hundreds of dollars if you want a really high resolution with the best specs. But anyway, so let's look at these two to start with. Now, the block diagram for the 5034 is given on the next page. So the heart of it is an SAR. It has the 8-bit outputs here, and it's got an output enable, so these will be floating until you drop this line low. It's got your clock input. Here's the start convert. This is going to be an active low to start the process. When the process is done checking out all 8 bits, the data ready line goes from a high to a low. It's got a reference current, so you got to set up a V and I on the external part of the circuit to set up a reference current. And then it's got the I in at this point, which is actually the analog output value. It's got two separate grounds, the digital ground and the analog ground. And if you place an external capacitor between pins 11 and 17, you can dictate the frequency at which this operates at. And figure 15-16 shows the value of the capacitance versus the frequency of operation for the SAR. If you don't use the external capacitor, the internal capacitance is used, and the frequency versus conversion time is shown in part B. But an even more popular ADC is the 0804. There's a whole series of these. There's the 801, the 802, and so on. And the 804 is the one I was saying. It was pretty inexpensive, $2 or $3, and it interfaces nicely to a microprocessor. We've done a lot of this in lab, where we've actually put an analog value into this, and it dumps its information 8 bits in parallel right off to a port on a microprocessor or microcontroller. And basically it has the following pins. It's got an active low chip select, just to make the chip active in the first place. The NOT-RD is the output enable. It's called the NOT-RD, and that's a common signal used in microprocessors. And the WR is used for write, which means start the conversion process. It's got a clock in. It's got the interrupt. Now the interrupt is issued as an output as soon as the end of conversion, the data is ready. It's got a VN plus and a VN minus, which is a differential analog input. Usually what I do is ground one pin for single-ended, and just bring, so I ground the minus and I just bring the analog in on the VN. So that's what's good about this. This is a voltage in and a digital output value. And the digital outputs, of course, are the D0 through D7. What else do we have? We got a separate analog ground, digital ground. Now we also have an optional reference voltage, and we use this a lot to override the reference voltage assumed at VCC. So if VCC set up at 5 volts, that's our reference voltage. But if you want to have a different full-scale reference voltage, you can use the VREF over 2 pin. And to if you set up an external RC, you can set up the clock frequency using this equation. And this figure shows the internal wiring of this integrated circuit. It does have 3 stated output latches. It's got an internal SAR. It uses a shift register along with an SR flip-flop to deal with the SAR controls. And here I'm showing the external R and C that you'll end up using to dictate the operation frequency. And then figure 17 shows the pin layout for the ADC0804, which you can get. I got this from NXP Semiconductors, but other manufacturers make the same chip. You can find this on the internet. And then the best way to see how this works is to look at an actual application. Now what I've got here is an analog voltage that I'm going to vary from 0 to 5. I'm setting up the reference at 5 volts because the VCC is 5. That's going to be the default value. And I grounded the minus input. This is all the analog side of the circuit. The digital side of the circuit has D0 through D7 attached to it, and they're active high outputs. So when we actually, if we had 0 coming in, we'd see 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 on the output. All the LEDs would be off. I'm sorry, all the LEDs would be on. So the LED, because the anodes are all tied to the plus 5, they turn out to be active low. You have to put a low to turn a light on. So when you input 0 volts on the analog, you'd have 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, all the lights would be on. So when you're looking at this, you have to keep in mind that it's the off lights that are active. And here's our external RC connections, and I ground the other pins to all to the digital grounds. So the fact that the chip select is grounded, that means the chip is always active, and the NOT-RD means that the outputs are always active. This is the output enable, remember? Now, the write and interrupt. Now, when this thing is first powered on, we have an RC circuit. This starts out at a low and then goes float, because this is a buffer chip, an open collector buffer. So when it's low, this output's a low, and this low goes up to the WR, which does a start convert. After this thing is already started, this capacitor charges up and this output becomes a float, which means this is just not connected anymore. Now the float allows the INTR, once this data ready or when the end of convert is done, this line goes low. And as soon as this line goes low, we have this connection back in. It starts the conversion again. This is called continuous conversions, because as soon as the data is ready and we have the EOC, end of convert, this line goes low, starts another convert. This line goes low, start another convert. So it's continuously changing values. So you'll see these lights changing as you vary this variable voltage. And as you turn this slightly, you'll see these lights changing. So because the analog input voltage is directly proportional to the digital output, the following ratio can be used as an equation to solve the digital output value. You just set up a ratio. The analog in relative to the VREF is proportional to or equal to the digital out versus 256. So if you want to solve for D out, use a little algebra, you would come up with this equation. And the VREF is actually going to be the voltage on pin 20, which is your VCC pin, or it's going to be whatever's on pin 2, which is the VREF over 2. It'll be that value times 2. And then the digital output will be whatever it is converted to base 10 and then versus 256. So example 15.5 illustrates how we would calculate which LEDs would be on for different voltages. So if I take VCC and make it 5.12, I just did this because it's going to work out to nice even numbers if I do that, because we're dividing by that multiplying by the 256, this works out. Determine which LEDs will be on if you have 5.100. Here's the equation. You put in 5.100 relative to the reference I told you to use. This math works out exactly to 255. So I pick this number. This 5.100 is the max analog input you could use if you had 5.12, because that gives you the number 255, which is all ones, which means all the LEDs will be off. None of them will be on. Let's look at the next voltage, 2.26, and when you put 2.26 into this equation, you'll end up with 2.26 over 512. You do this math and you end up with 113 base 10. You got to convert that to binary to find out which LEDs will be on, and the ones that are on are the ones that's received the zero. So the LED 7 will be on, the LED 3, LED 2, and LED 1. So in the textbook, figure 15-19 shows a multisim simulation. Multisim has an ADC in it, and I'm looking at the 8 outputs on these hex displays, and I've got two variable potentiometers. I've got them both set at 0 right now. Let's take the fine adjuster and move that up to maybe up to the halfway point. I'll just slide it up. I could be just pressing the letter F. It would also move. I'll do F to get up to 50. And we still have nothing because the course is not set. So if I press the C button once, I go 10% of the full scale. This gives us 0.229 volts, which shows the number 6 at the output. And every time I press C, it's making these big jumps. And let's take C up and see where FF ends up. And I can't quite get there until I adjust the fine also. So I adjust the fine, start counting up with that, and I have to go quite a ways up. But anyway, I think you get the idea. You can take, well, let's just go, I'm almost there now. So there's FF, 5 volts. So this turns out to be a 5 volt max on the ADC, gives you that FF. So this is fun to play with. I'm going to hold the shift key and press F to go backwards. The other thing might be is how many volts would it take just to get the number 1 to find the step size and then the number 2. So you would have to adjust the course in the fine to find out the step size. So play around with this a little bit. This is already available for you on the companion website, and it helps you understand the ADC. So next, let's put this all together in the next section and look at a complete data acquisition system.